Global Vision presents a new program on the cutting edge of change.
This situation first should be redefined. They're making it complicated, and it is so simple. It is extremely simple. You have just bad guys and good guys, and bad guys are killing good guys, and unfortunately, it is supported by main political powers in the world.
I think that Sarajevo is a good example for the issue of unthinkable futures. The crucial difference between fiction and real life. Fiction must be plausible, real life has no such constraint.
Speaking as a Westerner and as a foreigner, I share the feelings of regret, I would say almost shame, at how little has been done by the international community to sustain the city in its hour of need. Even as we speak, the city is still under the most severe siege that Europe has seen since Leningrad 50 years ago. I would hazard one of the most severe sieges in the history of Europe. There are 12, perhaps 15,000 people dead in the soccer stadiums and the graveyards of this city. Another 50 to 60,000 people wounded, many of them so severely wounded that they will never walk or function normally again. And I believe that we in the West had the power to stop this.
My name is Fred Cuny, and I'm a consultant to improve the services to the people of Sarajevo and to Bosnia. There's a lot of black humor going around. Probably the most prevalent joke is the one about what's the difference between Sarajevo and Auschwitz, and that is Auschwitz had gas.
Good afternoon, this is Red News 8, Sarajevo, it's 6:36 p.m. What we're doing right now is a message to the world, the white, the black, the yellow, and red. World. So this is a message to the world, what the world should know, if the world were interested to know about us and what we really are.
It's almost impossible to film a feature when it's not war, because it's difficult. And can you imagine shooting it in a situation like this? I mean, it's absolute hell, you know. These filmmakers which are making these movies are just mixed like people in New York. I mean, I'm almost ashamed to say that we are multinational, multicultural, multi-ethnic people, because it's so obvious and it's so normal. And they wanted to make that impression that it's some kind of their ethnic war, and it's nothing like that. It's extreme right-wing nationalism, which is devastating. Also, you know, you tell me how can I be objective, but that cameraman was just doing professionally his job. He didn't take any side, you know, he was just showing it.
Sarajevo has to be destroyed, full stop. that Sarajevo represents something which counters the entire ideology of the war. The ideology of the war is that people cannot live together. But when you accept that it's an ethnic war, you were told that people cannot live together. You were told that something called Serb, Croat, and Muslim is a very true and concrete reality of difference with some kind of justification, in fact, for genocide, when in fact there are very specific political purposes and reasons behind the war, and it has nothing to do with some kind of innate, inborn, inbred hatred.
I feel the extreme moral obligation to be there. And it's not Sarajevo problem, it's not Bosnia problem, it's a problem of whole world.
Yes, General, yes.
As Adamir Kenovich said to me when he showed it to me, he said, this is something you're never gonna forget as long as you live, and it's true. It's just straight on footage of people lying on the ground who have just been killed by a Serb shell that has landed in the middle of the street and caught these passers-by. It's not the pornography of death, there's nothing voyeuristic about it. It just makes you confront, as nothing I've ever seen, what the reality of murder is. This is not war, this is murder. This is a genocide. It's been a genocide going on all through and throughout Bosnia, and the targets are civilians. Nothing matches what Saga has done in the completeness of the record. So they have a continuity of point of view, of time, of knowledge of the city. And every time they go out to do any filming, the Saga people are literally risking their lives.
It's a privilege for me to be given the opportunity to speak about the work that Adamir Kenovich and the entire Saga crew has done here. Adamir has been for me not only a close personal friend during the time of the siege of Sarajevo, he has introduced me to the city, to many of the most courageous and noble people in this city, and he's made a great deal of difference to me in my coverage of the siege of Sarajevo and to thus my ability to tell through the pages of the New York Times what has happened here.
Well, I'll give you a typical day. Just before sunrise, we usually start getting the artillery barrages. The Serbs begin firing down from the hills at random into the city, firing at the areas that are closest to the lines with snipers, machine guns, and so forth. And then from the hillsides, they fire randomly into the downtown area of the city, and periodically will fire up into the upper reaches of the hills. Sometimes they'll concentrate their fire on one or two buildings. Often they'll try and bracket the UN buildings or the areas where people would be going to the UN for assistance or for help. They'll often fire at areas they know the UN may be distributing food or relief supplies in.
Why was I interested in bombs in particular? Because I think that most people, or almost all people in this city, have become beggars of some sort. Bums. As soon as the sun comes up, from the early, early morning, when the sun comes up over our beautiful mountains, almost everyone has to go out, find some water, beg for a couple of kilograms of flour to make bread, to find some wood so they can light a fire and make that bread. It's like the entire city has been transformed into a concentration camp that is dying slowly from one day to another.
Now I feel we are on some kind of different level. I'm not comparing it in a qualitative term of the world, but we're just different now. You know, all shock after shock, shock after shock, deaths, hungers, telephones doesn't work, there is no water at all, there is no food at all, there is no medical supplies anymore. There is practically nothing.
We are at the market, one of the markets of Sarajevo that become a black market during the war. All you need you can find here, not in the shops because they do not exist. All things that you can see are very expensive. For example, one can of a Coke is from $5 up to $10. Vegetable, fruits, and all things are very expensive. Most of the citizens are smokers, and one package of a cigarettes are about $5 and sometimes even more expensive. So you can imagine how hard it is to live and to shop in this city.
Nema mi pjesme bez Sarajeva. Last summer, somebody asked me to make a story about starvation. And I call up a friend who had two little daughters. I said, let's shoot something about your food. And he says, well, but we don't have food. I said, okay, but what are you feeding your daughters with? He says, well, every morning, I drip a finger in a little bit of salt and they lick it. And at night, I put my finger a little bit of sugar and they lick it. And that's all that we have.
More than 10,000 people death in Sarajevo. It's more than 3,500 kids death in Sarajevo. And people just don't understand the number, 3,500. You have to start with one kid going to school, getting into his class, meeting his 35 mates, and then they 35, they go to school ground and they play with other kids. And they are all slaughtered, and that's just one school out of 10 schools that make number of 3,500.
Bio sam prva ruke. Pala je granata, mama je mene, stinu I mamu. Mama je vama na hirurgiji.
The great big world with incredible cynicism is not only watching, but actively participating in producing the Bosnian tragedy. For this shameful behavior, they have a few stereotypical excuses. The first is that this is a civil war. The second is that this is danger to the civilized and Christian Europe from Islamic fundamentalism. And then that this is an inexplicable tribal ethnic conflict that can't be solved but by having a people totally exterminated.
U Dobrim 5 ja sam živla, on je radio Dobrim 5 u ovom kafiću, dva dim, pošto sam ja tu izlazila I u radiju, poznao se prvo, onda malo pomalo profuram, što kaže, I eto onda oko 10. maja meni je bio rođendan, 18 napunula I 12. maja mi se vidimo, onda vjerim se baš s ovim prstom. Vjerujem se I kontali smo 15. maja da se uzmemo. Međutim, ja 14. maja odem u Buća potok sa svojima, preko Mojmila kad se išla. Tako sam ja gore bila, nisam ga vidjela skoro mjesec I pol, pogotovo čula. I onda kad je došao, se izgubiš kad ga vidiš. Nije da su bili protiv, oni su volili Alena I sve, pogotovo moj otac I mama. Ali, meni mama stalno, pa sačekaj dok završi ovo, pa kad si mogla do sad, možeš sačekati još malo. Pa ne daj Bože da mu se šta desi, kako bi. sačka još malo. Ma kakvi? Kako čakala. Na dva mjeseca sam bila gore. Em ga je čudan, ga je čudan. A vidite, kad sam ga vidla ja ovako. Kratko je, nam je trajalo leto. Kratko je slatko. Bila u kući. Došao ovaj Marinko jedan. Kaže, zove te Irfan. Pitanje je Marinka, je Lalen tamo? Kaže, jeste. I kad smo došli pred bolnicu, prvo što sam pomislila Valenu šta bilo. Jer međutim, mi smo ušli u onu.
Rođen 25.6.1970. rodne u Bileći. Dimijanovića Disa, rođena 10.5.1974. rodne u Sarajevu. U državi Bosne i Hercegovine, odlučili su na današnji dan da stope brak. Oko mera. 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 Oko Jelen Čustović izrazio želju da stupi u brak sa ovdje prisutnom Milanović Adisom. Postavljam Adisi pitanje da se izjasni u svom prezimu. Adisa, možete zadržati svoje prezime djevojačko, možete svom prezimu dodati prezime svoga supruga i možete uzeti prezime svog supruga. Možete potpisati.
Tako, pošto je to bila i njegova i moja želja, a nije nam se ostvarila. Tako sam, eto, tog dana kad su ga sahranili prije sahrane, smo se vjenčali. Nije nam se ostvarilo onako kako smo htjeli. Pa evo ovako.
Brak proglašavam sklopljenim.
I ovo je Jelen.
Sretna jesam bila to nepuna dva mjeseca. Ali ono odjednom, eto, od te granate, odjednom se život preokrene, ono, skroz. Umjesto da budem sad tamo i ono, Alen dođe, sve normalno, ono, sjedite, pričate. Sad ovako, rat je tako. Bila sam kod ljekara, imat ćemo bebu. bebu, mili. Moju i tvoju. Našu bebu.
Sarajevo is could probably best be described as a city that's very similar in scale to Seattle. It's a city that is vertical. It has lots of hills, has a river that runs through the middle that has a lot of history associated with it. The downtown area is modern in one area, or it was modern. You have an old town that that blends the cultures of East and West together, much in the same way as Istanbul probably does. It has modern TV towers, and since the Olympics, had a very modern tram system and mass transportation and so forth. Today, it's all in ruins.
During this war, they've been trying mercilessly to destroy us. And my contribution to the battle against that is that turning all that's negative into positive vibrations of the spirit. When they enabled my daughters to go to school, I invented a game, and within 15 days I managed to teach them all the letters. When they destroyed the electricity, I tried to produce my animated film on window panes. When they turned off the water, I joined my neighbors and dug this well. So why are we here? Because just like Sarajevo, this is the idea. All the neighbors got together. All of us. Serbs, Croats, Muslims, people with their own tragedies. And together, we dug up this well. And here, let me show you an example. Kiko, say hi to the viewers in America. Kiko and Lilja are a couple, a Muslim and a Serb. They've been apart from their children for a year and a half now. They've been digging up this well with us. And that's the way it's going to be in the future too.
We are living always together, all nations, you know, and Muslims and Croats and Serbs and Jewish, and in Bosnia we have 700,000 mixed marriage. I am from mixed marriage, you know, and what? We are living together, no ethnic war. No ethnic war.
In Sarajevo, you have existing structures of people every day in the most simple and small ways actually living together very, very well. And if that survives, then the whole ideology of the war and the proof and justification for genocide exists. If Sarajevo can be destroyed, completely erased, and I think in a sense that's the ultimate goal, then people will begin to forget, and the justifications for the war may be able to withstand.
That story about multi. We have all multi things in Sarajevo. We just miss maybe one thing, multivitamins. Natural that Saka are producing the military clips. This is war propaganda for the mobilizing people to defend themselves. And you must use some stereotypes, and you must show guys who are in a good form, running and doing things, because that's what warring is. You are surviving, you are going to eventually kill somebody else. But the point is that you are doing that trying to defend your families, your children. So you are going to kill to stop the killings. That's the paradox of the war.
Sarajevo is not going to surrender. It It's not going to go down in some sort of a compromise deal. It's not going to go down because the European and UN negotiators put a lot of pressure on them. It's not going to go down because the West withholds food aid to try and force a settlement. If it goes down, it's going to go down fighting, and it's go down in a fight to the last house. And the Serbs are going to probably have to pay a very high price if they want to do that. Now, they can probably cut off all the supplies, continue to shell for a much longer period of time, create the misery, the deaths, the disease that any besieged city eventually will end up with, and they can do it in winter to make it especially miserable. But they're not going to force the people of that city to surrender. The army is made up of people who have come from ethnically cleansed areas. They've lost their families. They've lost their friends. They know what it's like to be driven out in shame. And they are determined not to go through it again.
Sarajevo is a very weird, unusual city. Perhaps that's why it survived. Most people say of their native cities that they're weird and unusual, but Sarajevo really is. And it is not true that the clash of cultures takes place on the rivers Drina or Runa or any of these ideas that they seem to impose upon us. The clash of cultures of East and West is in Bosnia. And should Bosnia dissolve, should it be torn apart, then you will have greater confrontations between these two civilizations.
It's a peak of an iceberg that you are watching in Sarajevo. You think it's only Sarajevo. If it's only Sarajevo, I mean, it wouldn't be the problem at all, you know, but it's not Sarajevo. It's just human beings on one side, and brutal, cannibalistic, I mean, fascist is a nice word for them only. You know, it's very dangerous situation. And it is just beginning of the flame. If it's not stopped, it's gonna burn, first of all, the whole territories around Macedonia, Albania, Turkey, Greece, then Russia is so close.
Stvari, da, ja sam pomislio da će baš što se više dešavaju ove, ta, ne znam, te nesreće, da će ljudi postati sve bliži i bliži, da će se zgušnjavati, da će osjetiti kad je ovako život ovako potrošan, jel, ovaj, kad svake sekunde može pasti granat i ubiti nas, da će se početi ljudi ovaj držati jedni drugih i da će, ne znam, pomagati jedni druge. Ali međutim, desilo se upravo obrnuto, a to je, sve se razbilo na param parča, svaki čovjek je jedna zatvorena cilina sama.
My student, film student, I haven't seen him for 4 months at the beginning of the war. I met him, I said, what have you been doing, Srđan? He said, I burnt legs. I said, I beg your pardon, I don't understand. He said, he explained to me that he was taking amputated parts of the body into the crematorium during his work as a medical assistant in the hospital. I said, you've got to make a film about this.
Navikao sam, tako reći, bez njih. Mogu sve da radim ko sam radio prije, sam normalan sad sa nekim poteškoćama. Ima male poteškoće kad pravim grudu, ne mogu na primjer napraviti tvrdu grudu, veliku. Mogu napraviti jednom rukom mala grudu, mekana. Ima poteškoća, pravljenje, brudri to. Pomažem sada dijel tijela, pravim grudu od sebe, ako naprijed.
Why I am filming this all, and why I am doing this with all my people, apart from the showing to the world what's happening, I think that this realm, unfortunately, in which I live, will be the subject of investigations in next decades, to be able to realize what really was happening, why that was happening, how was that possible. I was curious to see how these people look, these people who are killing, what are they, what do they represent. I got there, I applied in this where they were in prison. So they let me in, and I talked before any formal talks were held with him, you know, those like investigations and things. It was 3 days after he was called.
13 нас пустил в крест. Jest bio prije na radio na MUP u Bosni i Hercegovini, Sarajevu. I obučavao nas je na svinjama. Uzme svinju, drži je za uši i obori je na zemlju dole. Uzme je nož i zakolje. Tako smo i mi radili. Sve. Oborimo svinju, mala svinja, nije velika. I uzmemo nož i zakoljemo je preko grla dole.
Kako su to nože bili?
Famipa Prizren. To su velike nože, ovako.
Toliki nože?
Jeste.
Dobro, koga su prvo ti zapravo, sjećam se?
Bio je, napali su nas, bio na Dragači, smo držali položaj. I napali su nas gore, okružili su nas i mi smo ih razdvojili. I tu smo ih ufatili i ovaj rekao, bili su u uniformi, oduzeli oružje, oduzeli smo im oružje.
Oduzeli ste nekog,
jel? Jeste.
Koliko je bilo?
Šest.
Šest,
jel? Jeste. Bili smo ja, Zdravo Danilo i Zdravo Dragan. Sedno. I oni su mi naredili da ih moram ubiti. I ja sam uzeo nož.
Poznavao te ljude s koji bili komši, nisu?
Nisu. Kasnije smo ustanovili da su iz Visokog došli. O tom iz...
Borci iz
Visoka.
I šta, uzeo snož?
I ona je ga zdravo, Dragan oborio ga je na zemlju dole. Puškom udario ga je. I meni je rekao...
Koji dio?
Automatska puška, kundako.
U glavu, u nogu.
U glavu. I meni je... Jeste. Meni je rekao da uzmem nož i da ga ubijem.
Dobro.
Ja sam uzeo nož, uzeo ga zakus. Dole je pognuo prema zemlji. Prerezom rad.
Jedan put.
Yes, jedan put.
You see that it's nothing individual in him. It's nothing, you know, of a hatred. It's just part of a system. I was told to kill those people. I was ordered to rape those women because of a raising moral.
Nam rekli da moramo ići u Sonju, u zatvor Sonju. Tamo ima žena da siluju. Radi borbenog morala, za podizanje borbenog morala. I mi smo, moramo ići, tako nam rekli.
Dobro, i?
I prvi put smo otišli, Miča Damjanović Očgan zove, to da se dole ide.
Koliko ima tu žena, kilora? Prilike?
50.
50.
Sam poznao, no dobro. I oni su rekli, soba je tam bila. Otvorio sob Miro Vuković i rekao cura da izađe otalde i da nama je dao tu djevojku.
Kako se zvala, kako izgledala, znao? Mlađa, starija?
20 godina.
20,
ne? Jeste.
Znaš joj ime?
Amela.
Amela. Bila lijepa, onako kako?
Jeste, lijepa je bila.
Lijepa.
I... Dalas, gore smo otišli u sobu, na spratu, on je otišao gore sa njom, Miro Vuković. I ključ gore iz sobe i otvorio nam vrata, evo vrata što ćete od nje. I mi smo tu došli, skinuli je.
Kako ona reagovala na to, da se opirala?
Jeste, opirala se, ali bio je Miča, bila se četvrca. I nije mogla ono...
Je li pružala otpor?
Jeste.
Kako ste vi to uradili, tu prije, šta ste radili?
Udarali s mene 2-3 puta.
Čime?
Šakama. Šamar, udar. I skinuli smo i po četvrce silo. Po jedno.
I have maybe this problem of, as a surgeon, as my students said, you know, of this problem of not really sensing some things, because it's probably blockade of in brains which enables you to live, because it would fall apart otherwise.
onako, nemam snova. Nisu mi uopšte snovi povezani. Jedno mi dođe slika bijenog čovjeka, pa odjednom se promijeni to, pa se probudim, oznajem sa. Ne imam mira kad spavam uopšte.
I think it's very important that there is film production during the war. For various reasons. First, this is a manner of surviving psychologically through work, writing something in time. I think it's also important as document for the times that will come.
I was seeing my very life. I mean, that's the truth, what we saw. That's what we living in Sarajevo. It was transferred in the movie, the whole complex of feelings and emotions.
So then it makes sense when Pozzo says, "You're making me nervous," that then Miliana...
People are often surprised that there is any theater activity in Sarajevo. They imagine there's nothing but coping with the siege and dodging the bullets and the shrapnel. But there is a lot of normality in Sarajevo, which makes everything even more poignant and moving. I chose to do Waiting for Godot. That was my first choice. It seemed an obvious choice because it did seem to illustrate a lot of the things that people are feeling now in Sarajevo. The play is about weak, vulnerable, abandoned people trying to keep their spirits up while they wait for some unknown or greater power to help them out, and that's very much the situation of people there. People are very tired there, and one of the things that struck me all through the rehearsal process is whenever I stopped something that was going on the stage, it might only take a minute, but everybody immediately either sat down or lay down on the stage. One of the characters in Waiting for Godot is a man named Lucky who has to carry a lot of suitcases. This actor, who's a very good actor, weighs 110 pounds now. He weighed a lot more at the beginning of the siege 17 months ago, and he found it hard to carry 3 suitcases of light material. One was cardboard, actually, that were empty. He found it a physical effort. And the most important thing is to do good work there, not to condescend to them and say, okay, this is what I did with you and you're so tired and I'm so wonderful because I came here and so anything we do is rather marvelous. I didn't feel they were applauding because, oh, this crazy American writer came to Sarajevo. I thought they were applauding because I saw something that was good.
The cohesiveness of the society has not broken down per se. You have a lot of gloom. People are looking at facing another winter. They're saying, my God, we got through the last one. It was a mild winter, but it was miserable. What are we going to do if it's a bad winter? Where are we going to get the fuel? How are we going to heat the houses? How are we going to cook our food? Where are we going to get the water? Do we have to stand in line for hours in sub-zero temperatures trying to bring the water up like we did last year? All of these things are really creating a lot of anxiety in the city, and a lot of tension as people just despair. But it hasn't broken down the spirit of cohesiveness between the groups.
Sarajevo, there isn't one single family that hasn't had a loss of some sort. In Sarajevo, there isn't one single family that is still complete, that they're all together. And even if it weren't for the 200,000 dead people killed by the Serbian fascist aggressors, even if it weren't for the hundreds of death camps in which our people, the Bosnian Muslims, sometimes even Bosnian Croats and Serbs, who don't agree with the fascist regime of Slobodan Milosevic. And if we didn't have the camps in which 30,000 of our sisters, mothers, daughters were raped, and if among them we didn't have 5,000 small girls and young girls who were held in an imposed pregnancy so that they can't abort and take out of this world the children of crime. Even if we didn't have all these monstrous crimes, if we only had the crime of separation of fathers from their daughters, mothers from their sons, husbands from their wives, brothers from their sisters, sisters from their brothers, it is such a heinous crime, a crime that is not known in the entire world.
We, of course, do not hope that any of these incompetent politicians in the world, any of those morally absolutely minus people will do anything to try to stop suffering of these people. But we really think that we are fourth force. We are force which is stronger than any force armed with weapons or with political power. We are just people who want to try to continue living, to continue creating the documents from all this which is held in Sarajevo.
Somebody said, I'm not quite sure who, maybe it was Edmund Burke, that it, for evil to triumph it is necessary only for good men to do nothing. In this case, we in the West were the good men. We did not do nothing, but we certainly did not do anything like enough to stop this tragedy. We left, in essence, Sarajevo to defend itself. People like Ademir and his colleagues, Serbs and Muslims and Croats and Jews and Slovenians, people who represent what this city stands for, what this city has been for 500 years, they were not found wanting when this challenge arose. The example that they have given, I think, shames those who chose not to stand up at this time, but stands as a shining example to everybody, to all of us. And I think that the people of Sarajevo, the people of Bosnia, and all people in the arts around the world can be proud of what they've done.
I cannot understand some people who kill women and children.